What I'm assuming is happening is that these bees are becoming weak for some reason, and Nosema is one of those things, like viruses, that can then take off and take advantage of a weakened host. And that's, I think, where we need to find the stress factor or whatever it is that's going on that's allowing, in some cases, viruses to take off and kill bees.
So what was making these widespread diseases become so fatal? What was it in the environment that was causing bees to become weakened? Could it be the very way that hives were being kept? Bees have been put under stress by man for as long as we found a way to exploit them. And many of the bees' problems seem to stem from this.
There's a whole mythology of how wonderfully selfless the bees are. There's this phrase, non nobis, they work but not for themselves. And that's a very convenient way of getting around the fact that for most of human history, we have stolen from the bees, we have robbed them of their honey, and then we've killed them every year. And if you think of the classical skep beehive, which is the kind of Winnie the Pooh cuddly hive that most of us picture if we think of a beehive, it wasn't so cute and cuddly for the bees. It was really effectively like a kind of mausoleum, because for most beekeepers, they couldn't figure out any way of harvesting the honey other than poisoning the bees en masse, killing them all, and then taking the honey.
That's how our forefathers often gathered honey, by killing bees.
It was only in the mid-19th century when a brilliant clergyman who was also a beekeeper called Langstroth discovered this concept of bee space, which was exactly the amount of space you needed to leave in a hive, which would ensure that you could remove a frame of honeycomb without the bees filling up the space with bee glue and building more honeycomb, that you could consistently harvest honey without having to kill all the bees.
So Langstroth had found a way to keep bees alive and farmed. But there was an additional benefit. These new hives were easily portable. They could be stacked on trucks and moved around to meet the demands of pollination. So farmers no longer needed wild bees to pollinate their crops. They could clear land into massive fields where native bees struggled to survive. Nowhere more greatly symbolises the dominance of monocultures than the almond orchards of California's Central Valley.
The almond crop in California wouldn't happen without bees. I mean, it takes three things to make almonds. It takes, first you got to have almond trees, but that's four things. I guess you got to have almond trees, but you got to have water, sunlight, and bees.
More than a million hives are required to be brought into this 600,000-hectare area in the first weeks of February. That's 80% of the hives in the US.
One time, mostly California bees pollinated the almonds. Then it got, you know, bees from the Dakotas and so on moved down. As the almond crop grew, you know, it took more bees. And now with, you know, the disappearance of the bees from CCD, bees are coming from all over the United States to pollinate the crop.
Good beehives.
Yeah, it's a good one.
Have the more.
With hives renting out at over $150 a week, it's a vital revenue stream to beekeepers who congregate from across the nation.
Beekeepers, I hear 90% of their income is the almond crop. So if that's what you're relying on every year and you don't have the bees to do the pollination job, I don't know how they're going to survive the next year.
But being shipped from place to place isn't a natural existence for bees.
The stresses that bees are under in a commercial outfit are different than having a couple of hives in your backyard or even a commercial outfit that's permanently based.
Dave Mendes runs a large operation with over 8,000 beehives. Although Dave's based in Florida, his bees are being readied for a 3,000-mile trip to California for almond pollination.
I am not excited about shipping my bees to California. I'm doing this to survive.
Even though his bees are dying and he knows that trucking could be dangerous for them, with his business threatened, Dave has no choice but to carry on.
We're spending a whole pile of money to try to figure out how to keep these bees alive. I've tripled my feed bill. I've more than doubled my labor bill. You do everything you can. One-third of your bees respond really well. One-third of your bees are okay. One-third of your bees just lay there and dwindle, and sometimes you just want to shake them and try to figure out what's wrong.
Across the year, Dave's bees travel thousands of miles to meet the demands of different crops. Could this mass movement be a factor in the hive deaths?
You can move healthy bee colonies around, no problem. No problem. It's a bit like moving humans around. You get there and you spend half a day orienting, where am I, and then you're fine. And bees are like that too. They're resilient. They really are. But if they're a little bit compromised by something and you move them to a location and say, okay, time to work, and they're, whoa, you know, wait a minute.
We loaded some trucks last night, and they're looking at the weather, and it's going to be hot. If you hit hot weather, you're going to need to water the bees in the evening. If you hit cool weather, then... Right. If you're thirsty, so are the bees. Okay, right on the back of the truck here.
The problem with blaming trucking is that it's been going on for over 40 years without obviously affecting bees. Though nowadays, hives are moved more often.
There's always been a group of people that say, yeah, those commercial guys that move their bees around, you know, they're ruining the bees in the United States. Well, they're also pollinating the fruits and vegetables that we need for the United States.
Every 18 inches is fine.
And these beekeepers really care for their bees.
I know they're bugs. I know they're insects. But if your job is to keep bees alive, and you can't do that for whatever reason, and you can't even know why they're dying, you feel like a failure.
The highest losses were reported by the big commercial beekeepers who moved their bees around. But then they also had the highest number of hives. Studies showed no clear link between the husbandry of individual beekeepers and the likelihood that their colonies would be blighted. As Dave's bees headed to California, Brett Ady, who'd taken his bees west months earlier, was discovering a vanishing of staggering proportions.
I seen one hive sitting there. I don't know if there's any bees left in it. I don't know if there's anything here or not. Just a little drizzle, a few bees there. They're not enough. They're not viable. No, they're gone. They just don't know it yet. There's like six bees there. There's no queen. So.
In less than 2 months, Brett Ady had lost perhaps 200 million bees.
We came back in January after Christmas break, and we had beehives that looked beautiful and ones that were trash. You know, we originally thought we were limited to a third, but it's been much worse than that.
And this was after Ady had gone to extraordinary lengths to protect his bees.
They had all kinds of stores. They had honey, they had pollen, and we supplemented them with sugar, we supplemented them with pollen substitute, and they were beautiful bees until it turned cold. I've talked to guys that have lost 3/4 of their operation and one man that lost over 80% of his operation. Those aren't sustainable numbers. We've got to either get to the end of this or beekeeping won't be the same in the United States, because we can't afford to lose those kind of numbers continually.
Yeah, there's a fence on both sides.
Arriving for the almonds, beekeepers Dave Mendes and Dave Hackenberg caught wind of the massive disappearance and rushed to see the thousands of wrecked hives.
It keeps going, all the way up into the hills. Every semi-spot. If he's not upset, there's something wrong here.
In the back of your mind, you think you have an idea what this looks like.
You can't imagine this. This is like the pictures of the Holocaust. This is a bee Holocaust right here.
All the way up that valley.
This whole thing doesn't make any sense. And if you don't see it yourself, it's monsters in the closet. When the bees are dead, you kind of seeing the end product of it, but how you got from the beginning to the end is still very unclear for all of us.
I just want to see if there should be, this is what's disturbing. There should be dead, yeah. You see, this many hives, that's not enough dead bees here for this many hives.
There's flowers
you
here.
You see it?
You should have flowers.
Well, it's not enough dead bees.
So what was causing these mass vanishings? Why had bees left the hive and not returned? It seemed not to be just a virus. It wasn't just stress from trucking. There had to be another factor. Some beekeepers began to point the finger at an old foe, pesticides.
Please don't go crazy if I tell you the truth. No, you don't know what happened, then you never will.
It's partly due to pesticides that we've been able to develop large monocultures. Because without them, vast areas dominated by a single crop would quickly become blighted by the bugs that feed on them. Pesticides are, by their very nature, killers. Early pesticides, like DDT, killed pretty indiscriminately, and this had a devastating effect on wild bees. However, more modern chemicals have been designed to target specific plants and specific pests. That's the theory, at least.
It's a simple suggestion. Can you give me some time? So just say yes or no. Why can't you shoulder the blame? 'Cause both my shoulders...
Colorado beekeeper Tom Theobald has battled for a greater understanding of the impact of these chemicals on bee health for many years. As his bees began to die, he became convinced of a connection.
I'm not an extremist. I understand that pesticides are going to be used, but I think they need to be used with care and good judgment. And we have some very simple laws that would encourage that kind of usage, but they're routinely ignored and disregarded. And as a consequence, there's enormous damage that's being produced by pesticide usage. This is the yard where I had the highest winter losses, 80%. 10 out of 12 didn't make it. So I'm trying to rebuild the numbers, and there probably won't be 100 crop from this bunch. I'm concerned that we may be seeing some very subtle consequences of this chemical environment that we've been forced to live in.
Pesticides weren't meant to kill bees, but hives left in fields were often caught in the crossfire of the battle between farmers and bugs. When crops were sprayed, beekeepers would try to ensure that their bees were safe from harm by removing hives. But as more sophisticated chemicals have developed, it's become perhaps harder to assess when they might be in danger.